Hello and welcome to NIOS Studio. Today I, Dr. Upasana Ray, is discussing with you the role of education in empowering girls. Ours is a male-dominated society. Women has been denied education through centuries because of social, cultural and economic reasons. Now you will ask me that is it important to empower women? Well, I shall show you this photograph. Can a car run in this way with two wheels on the ground and two is unable to reach the ground? Well, no. If we deny 50% of the population overall development, the nation cannot develop. Thus, empowering girl is of utmost empowerment to achieve a gender equal society. Thus, empowering girls is of utmost importance to achieve a gender equal society. What do we mean when we speak the word empowerment? The term empowerment has a prefix M to mean that it is to make or cause to be. Thus, the word empowerment can be defined as something to make powerful. The idea of power is at the root of the term empowerment. Now, if we discuss what is behind power, well, it operates in four different ways. First is the power over. Here the power involves a relationship of domination or subordination between individuals and groups. The second is power to, when I give power to a person to take his own decisions to solve their own problems. Next is power within, a power that comes from within the individual, that of self-confidence, self-awareness and assertiveness. Power with, this involves people organizing with a common purpose to achieve collective goals. Power over can be alternated by power to, power with, power within. The kinds of power described above as power to, power with and power within can be developed as alternatives to power over so that we can end the domination in the society. Exactly to speak, the patriarchal domination in the society. Now, when we talk of women empowerment, conceptualized as the redistribution of resources, what are the kinds of resources we have? We have natural resources, we have human resources, we have intellectual and financial resources. What comes under natural resources? Natural resources are land, water, forest. Intellectual resources are information and knowledge. Human resources are people, labor, skills, and financial resources are money and property. In the process of empowerment, women get control over these resources and challenge the power structure that caused their subordination. Thus, it enables them to gain greater access to knowledge from the knowledge sphere and fiscal resources from the financial sphere. Together, greater autonomy is achieved in personal matters to share power at domestic and political spheres of life. Empowerment is a dynamic process which aims at women's liberation, freedom of choice and equality in all spheres of life. It hereby helps women to freely analyze, develop their voice, their needs and interest without being imposed by others. Thus, ultimately this changes, women bring change in the society. Thus, ultimately through these changes, women are able to bring change in their life and in the society. Now, when we talk of empowerment, what does it mean? Who is an empowered woman? One who is self-reliant, who has a very high social self-esteem, has participation in developmental process, participates in decision making, has a vocation, participates in social change, even at one point of time can even trigger social change, aware about her rights and economically independent and automatically a very self-reliant person. The concept of empowerment thus is multidimensional. We can see when we divide these points, we can see that they are individual empowerment and there is collective empowerment. Individual empowerment can be drawn from socio-economic and political empowerment of the individual, while as collective empowerment lies in collective consciences and action. So we can even talk of individual empowerment as power within and collective empowerment as power with or power to. Indicators of low status of women. Why is this important? Because when we are talking of empowerment of women, undoubtedly India is lacking behind. So what are the things in which we can see that India is lacking behind and creating a low status for women? In India, the falling of sex ratio of women to men, low literacy rate, low life expectancy, unemployment, high maternal mortality, low medical facilities, high crime against women are all indicating the low status of women. Now, why is the status low? Traditionally, the status is low because of two major points. One is gender discrimination and other is the lack of education. Now, of the many policies that the government of India runs and in the constitution provides equality to females, we have gender disparity. Gender disparity is more in the rural areas considered to the urban areas and more so in the disadvantaged communities of the rural areas. To break these barriers of traditional practice which comes into the way of empowering girls and to question the power of imbalance, one needs to be empowered. One needs to be empowered, one needs to be aware, one needs to be conscious. And how does awareness and consciousness comes? By empowering, one gets greater control over circumstances that influence their life. Her access to knowledge and resources increases. She gains autonomy in personal matters and freedom from biased customs and taboos. It gives her a freedom of choice. Now, education is one of the path breakers that is giving her a freedom of choice. It is raising her consciousness, it is providing her with information that in turn is giving her knowledge. Now, education can be of two types. One is formal and the other is non-formal. Formal education is linked with schools and colleges and educational institutes. In formal education, the academic structure, standardized curriculum, full-time schooling makes it inconvenient for many rural and poor and disadvantaged girls for attending the schools. In spite of constitutional measures of free and compulsory education between 6 to 14 years of age, thus we see a large number of girls compared to boys are out of school. So, we have two kinds of dropouts among girls, one who have never attended schools and one who have attended and have dropped out of schools. Apart from the structure of the formal education system, the other constraints are a girl child, especially in rural areas, has to support her family through both paid and unpaid work. One has to collect drinking water, one has to collect food, and fodder for the animals, has to collect firewoods, has to do sibling cares. Early marriage is another big problem in rural areas. Thus, formal education system failed to reach what we call as hard to reach girls. As an alternative, do we have something? Yes. Non-formal education, NFE, came into the picture in the early 70s and the late 60s. These centers are an alternative to formal education meant to realize the goals of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan and Elementary Education, UEE. The NFE system is flexible, learner-centered and participatory. The learning process is more practical than theoretical. The system is more economical because it utilizes existing facilities. The system is more suitable to the dropout girls as it has no restrictions on entry age, no fixed timings. Classes can be held in the morning, afternoon or in the evening depending on the convenience of the girls. Curriculum is need-based and also includes life-skilled education. There is no need for professionally trained teachers. A local instructor works on honorary basis. NFE programs has been implemented through non-governmental organizations. The objective of formal and non-formal educations are basically complementary to each other. Both aim at improving the quality and raising the standard of living. Both contribute to the process of empowering girls through inculcating the values, attitudes, and other life skills. Mandate of the Constitution. The Article 45 imposed direct responsibility for education on the states. The state is made responsible to provide free and compulsory education to all children until the age of 14 years within a period of 10 years. The Article 15 imposed non-discrimination on the grounds of sex in the matters of gaining access to public resort. Article 15(3) empowered the state to make special provision for the welfare of the women and children. This resulted in special allocations and relaxation of procedures and considerations to expand a girl's access to education. Right in 2009, the Indian Parliament passed RTE, Right to Education Act, which ensures free and compulsory education yet again to children between 6 to 14 years. So through the government provisions, we can see that the government of India has taken many steps to ensure that education is provided to the girls. As we have been discussing earlier, that education is one of the path breakers that can lead to empowerment. Now, other government initiatives and policies, the first one we would like to discuss is that India signed the International Treaty CEDAW, Committee on Elimination of All Kinds of Discrimination Against Women, in 1980 and committed to implement it. National Policy of Education, formulated in 1986 and revised with Plan of Action in 1992. It recognized the need to redress the traditional gender imbalances in education access and achievement. It recommended using education as an agent of change in the status of women. Education enhances critical and thinking skills and self-esteem of the individuals and thereby empowers them to bring change in their life and in the society and thereby contribute to overall development of the nation. The next policy we'd like to discuss is the National Policy for Empowerment of Women, formulated in 2001, defined some key areas for action in women's education such as equal access, special measures to eliminate discrimination, universalization of education, gender-sensitive curriculum, and reduction of gender gap in education. The government also took some very good initiative as programs for rural girls. As we have discussed earlier, you have seen that the concentration of disparity is more among the rural as compared to the urban, and more with the disadvantaged community in the rural background. So the first policy that we can discuss is the NPGEL, National Program for Education of Girls at Elementary Level. It is a Government of India intervention to reach hardest to reach girls. We have already talked of hardest to reach girls, especially those who are out of school, that is those who have never come into the schools. The program, launched in 2003 as a component of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, mainly is in educationally backward blocks where the level of rural female literacy is less than the national average and the gender gap is above the national average. The program covered 3 to 7 blocks in 24 states. The program provides for development of a model school in every cluster with following measure. First, it talks of strict supervision on girls' enrollment. It talks of community mobilization. It talks of gender sensitization of teachers, developing gender sensitive learning materials, provision for need-based incentive like escorts, stationaries, and so on, and provision for additional classrooms. The program provides for development of a model school in every cluster with following measure: vocational training for girls, ECCE, that is early child care centers as support structure, building community support and cooperation for the women's education by organizing monthly meeting in village level schools, Development and Monitoring Committees, SDMC, Parent Teacher Association, PTA, meeting and Mothers Teachers Association, MTA meetings. Next, we have the scheme of Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya. The program was again launched in 2004 under the SSA. It covers educationally backward blocks and where female literacy rate is less than the national average and gender gap is above the national average. KGVBs are residential schools with the capacity of 100 girls, especially SC, ST and minority group. So we can see that this scheme completely focuses on the disadvantaged minority community. Special features of the schools are as follows: providing educational facilities for girls living in thinly populated areas, provides opportunity of non-enrolled girls including grown-up girls in rural areas, equip dropouts. We have to concentrate on the girls who were coming to school and has now dropped out. Equip dropouts for mainstreaming to normal school through bridge courses. It also helps to pursue education free from domestic core work and sibling care, provides residential facilities to create a free environment for learning, provides extra coaching for slow learners and repeaters, provides life skills trainings, provides girl-friendly infrastructure facility. Now we have to talk of the third scheme that came up is the Mahila Samaksha, is MS. Mahila Samaksha is a scheme of complete empowerment of women. Empowerment is a critical precondition for gender equality. To translate these goals, Mahila Samaksha program has been initiated in 1989 in 10 districts of 3 states, Gujarat, Karnataka and Uttar Pradesh, as a pilot program. Today, the program is implemented in 21,707 villages in 83 districts in 9 states. The program has organic linkages with other educational schemes aimed at universalization of elementary education such as SSA and DPEP. Mahila Samaksha, an autonomous body, works with NGOs, but the board has both government organization and non-government organization representatives. MS believes that education empowers women to achieve equality. The program is flexible and it does not have any deadline or target. It's a target-free program. Mahila Samaksha has Mahila Sangs, village-level women collectives, which are important nodal points of all activities. It provides a space for women to meet, to reflect on their issues and to articulate their needs through collective action. MS provides resource and training to support the Sangs to facilitate them to organize at block and district levels as pressure groups. They participate in all educational and developmental activities which enable them to take charge of their lives with their daughters and their children. The effect of the approach are visible in the Sangs. Sangs initiative can be seen in various issues like ensuring educational opportunities for children, especially girls, seeking literacy and innumeracy skills for themselves, tackling social issues such as violence against women, dowry, Devdasi system and so on, entering the political sphere, gaining control over health and nutrition, assessing control over resources and improving civic amenities. This sums us and brings us to an end of how education has been a triggering source of energy to break the traditional norms of patriarchy, of social barricading in the empowerment of girls. Education is a force that can bring forward empowerment within girls. Thus, the role of education is a vital source provider and a path breaker in the field where we need to bring equality between males and females. Thank you.